Hello and welcome back to Proactive New York. I'm Christine Corrado. With me right now is Matthew Plavan, CEO at Arcadia Biosciences. Matt, it's great to see you. How are you?
Great, Christine. Good morning.
Good morning, Matt. Q2 earnings out today for the company. You've been reporting a bit of progress around the commercialization of both GoodWheat and GoodHemp. Maybe we can start off with GoodWheat. Can you tell us a bit more about recent partnerships you've announced and what's really driving them?
Yeah, well, thank you. A lot of hard work. We've been conveying to our investors in the last couple of earnings calls that we had relationships that we were developing that were in the works. And in the last 10 days, we've announced three of those, both direct to consumer and business to business, or B2B, which are both very exciting channels for us, but very different channels. What we haven't talked much about is the direct to consumer channel, which is new for us. And represents, we think, a blockbuster opportunity. In particular, this channel through Tastemade and Tmall, which is, think of it as a lifestyle food and network, or lifestyle food and leisure network on the internet, where Tastemade and Tmall are accessing about 8 million people a month and demonstrating the preparation of foods, new products that they're bringing to the market, and then making those products available to those consumers. And China is a very huge market for U.S. foods for a number of reasons. And the fact that COVID has kept so many people home, the desire for healthy foods available at home over the internet has really skyrocketed. So we have very high expectations for our GoodWheat because it is a natural ingredient and provides that clean labeling that consumers are looking for. On the business-to-business channel, GoodMills, we've been talking about large CPGs such as GoodMills for the last two quarters. Very close to having a final agreement with them. They're in the midst of their final evaluations of the GoodWheat product in as an ingredient in their products. But given that we've talked about it a fair amount, and the delays that have occurred in bringing things to fruition because of COVID, we wanted to announce the term sheet stage. Normally we announce definitive agreements, but we really wanted to convey to our investors the magnitude and the potential of this partner. So that's the reason that we announced at the term sheet stage. And I would say the same thing about Three Farm Daughters, which is also a very important clean food, natural, healthy, lifestyle product offering through Three Farm Daughters. So GoodWheat in three channels, very capable and diverse channels, which is why we're pretty excited about being able to end the year with strong revenues from GoodWheat.
Thanks for that update on GoodWheat. Now turning to GoodHemp, you've acquired Industrial Seed Innovations. Why was that important for you to pursue in Q2?
Very popular varieties of hemp seed. Umpqua, Rogue, Deschutes, they are very popular amongst growers in the Pacific Northwest, California, and a few other states. Having such a good track record and such a robust customer base was really important for us to kind of extend our lead, if you will, in terms of being a provider of quality genetics. And we did just close with the definitive agreement with them recently. And so we're very excited to have them on board and to have their very popular varieties as part of our Good Hemp catalog. So we see very good things with regard to being able to extend the work they've done in bringing quality genetics to growers in the Pacific Northwest.
Well, speaking of hemp, what kind of economic and regulatory factors have impacted the demand of hemp that you've seen this far?
Yeah, that is a real issue for a lot of folks. And if you think about when the USDA approved hemp and made it legal in the U.S. in 2018 through the 2018 Farm Bill, they essentially gave the regulatory oversight to the FDA. But the time that the USDA said hemp is legal, the estimates that came out through the normal channels, the analyst reports from Markets to Markets and Grandview and others estimated that when you looked at all the markets that CBD had potential for, including CBD-infused beverages and as an ingredient in food and so forth, their estimates were between $16 and $20 billion in the U.S. by 2022, 2023. So the expectations were very high. So of course, a lot of growers wanted to be a part of that. And so they began growing hemp. The genetics were not very stable. So you had a lot of hemp coming to the market. But with COVID and just the time it takes the FDA to put together a regulatory framework, they've not been able to do that yet. And so the markets that have opened up for CBD have really been the topicals and tinctures, but the consumer product groups and companies that want to get in the space with CBD infused beverages and use it as an ingredient have basically said, we're going to stay on the sidelines until the FDA has made it clear how they're going to regulate. So although the market we think is about $1 billion now for the markets that opened, it's far short of what we thought it was going to be. So we ended up with some excess biomass out there in hemp and not the demand that we expected immediately. So that has really slowed things. And it's even had an impact on our ability to sell seed at the levels we expected at this point. However, I will say there's still a high expectation with that market, the size that it is, that we'll be able to sell a significant number of seeds through the balance of the year and into 2021. But we're all waiting with bated breath for the FDA to come out with their regulatory framework, because then we think it opens up the full market potential. And we think it'll really take off at that point.
Well, these two factors, how have they affected guidance for Arcadia?
Well, certainly we thought it prudent to given that the impact that these headwinds have on our ability to be real precise about our guidance, we pulled back from giving a specific number. But we were remain very bullish that, if the markets recover as we think they're starting to, that our ability to end the year with strong revenues by converting our hemp seed backlog to revenue, which is $3.7 million, and then the good wheat sales that I referred to earlier, those combined could really set us up for a strong ending to this year and a very strong entry into 2021 for revenue. And I even said in the call that if all goes to plan and our initiatives are unfettered by negative market conditions, that we could be in a position to be profitable on a quarterly basis coming out of 2021. We still see that as realistic if the markets cooperate.
Well, maybe turning to your HB4 drought tolerant soybeans, what can you kind of tell us about the latest achievements with this product?
Well, we ramped up to 3,000 acres of seed production, which is a lot, which really positions us well to bulk up and ramp up the production of our soybean in anticipation of the China markets opening with a potential China approval. Generally, I think the expectation is that those approvals would come to us or would be official in December of this year if the Ministry of Agriculture indeed does approve it. We believe there's speculation, although not officially confirmed, that the Ministry of Agriculture has actually planted for purposes of kind of the final stages of approval of our HB4. If that is indeed the case and we do get approval in China, I think we'll be off to the races with the commercialization of the HB4 soybeans. So that portends very well for 2021 and 2022 as well.
Good to hear, Matt. Thanks so much for the update today. Thanks so much.
Well, appreciate it. Have a great afternoon. Thanks, Christine.